Good evening, and welcome to our YouTube channel, Into the Darkness, where my friends and I play the Call of Cthulhu role-playing game. I'm your host, Thom. Tonight, we are going to have episode 2 of Mr. Corbitt, with yours truly as the GM. Thomas is going to do a recap for us, so Thomas?
All right, so the year is 1923, and on a warm mid-June Saturday in North Arkham, a group of neighbors gather together for a barbecue. Attending the friendly get-together is jazz club owner Francis McQueen, corporate lawyer William Robinson, tax lawyer Pat Leamer, cult fanatic Sebastian Carter, Professor Gregory Hall, private investigator Sidney Porter, librarian Lenora Clark, and small business owner Robert Perry. While our eight heroes know each other quite well, today's event also hosts a less familiar figure, a neighbor named Mr. Bernard Corbitt. The quiet and often reclusive Mr. Corbitt has only attended the hero social gatherings a few times in the past several years. A kind, quiet man, Corbitt has spent the last decade alone in his home after the passing of his wife. Though a successful businessman, owning and operating Corbitt and Porter's of America, his primary passion seems to be gardening. He's often seen managing his garden and often shares the bounty he grows in summer, as he's done at Robert's barbecue. Our heroes and Mr. Corbitt discuss many things at Robert's home, including the elusive and dangerous jackal, a man who has been slaughtering pets in Arkham neighborhoods. Despite the friendly conversation, Corbitt leaves to attend to some pressing matters at home. As the evening settles, half of the group decides to look more into the jackal, while the others inquire as to why Corbitt left so early into the barbecue. At Corbitt's house, Pat and William asked if he had a good time and if he'd be attending the next gathering at Robert's home next weekend. Corbitt gave an elusive response, but seemed quite busy with whatever he was doing inside. Meanwhile, the others investigated more on the jackal at the library, finding clippings that seemed to link the jackal to Arkham's Central Hospital. The next day, many of the neighbors went about their normal activities, but Gregory found himself curious of Mr. Corbett's success in the garden. When night fell, Gregory attempted to find what he believed to be a secret fertilizer, but was cut short by locked doors to the house and a painted padlock on the greenhouse. The next night, Gregory attempted for a second time to sneak into Corbett's locked greenhouse, but was stopped by Francis, then caught by Corbitt. The two were then asked to vacate the property and left Corbitt in a foul mood. The week leading up to the next social event at Robert's went on without incident. At Robert's, the group got together for lively conversation and food, and also noticed that Corbitt failed to make an appearance. Conversation went on without him, however, and the group continued to enjoy themselves over Robert's. For the most part, Robert found himself the host of a very successful afternoon, until he looked out his window to see Mr. Corbitt arriving home with a strange item, an item that Robert could have sworn looked like an arm.
So that's where we are. You're in the front parlor. Robert has just made his sudden sanity roll for jumping in the air from what he sees. And go ahead, whatever you guys want to do.
So I'm gonna.
You have all noticed him jump, by the way.
I ask him, what's you seem a little bit jumpy there.
Yeah, I don't know if I need to visit the local optometrist, but I just saw Corbitt arrive across the street while you guys were talking. And it looked like something, he dropped something as he was trying to get in his front door. And from here, I know it's, you know, across the street and a pretty far distance, but to me, it looked like a hand.
Preposterous.
Yeah, I don't really think Corbitt would do that kind of stuff.
I mean,
I don't either. That's what I'm questioning my eyesight here.
Well, I mean, Corbett? This, I mean, as a fan of pulp novels and mysteries, I don't think Corbett is the one to be such a one to carry a hand.
Somebody hand this good old boy another drink.
Yeah.
He needs it.
I will gladly take it.
Yes. I mean, if perhaps we should go and see Mr. Corbitt. Maybe we can invite him and perhaps, you know, clarify what, you know, what you saw.
Yeah.
Well,
you
don't need to bother the man about little things like this.
I know. I just simply don't want our guest or our host to feel, you know, to let it distract him.
Okay.
I'm just joking to Gregor and I'm saying, maybe that's what he puts in his fertilizer.
I chuckle at the thought. Not that I'm concerned. I mean, he is the only person that can really compete with me. I am clearly his equal. He just, you know, he did a nice spread.
Yeah.
Does anybody know Corbitt well enough to where, I mean, he disappears on these supposed business trips. Has anybody ever talked to him? Do we know where he's going? Or
I thought that you were the one who knew him the best. I mean, after all, he gives you
the key. Yeah.
I mean, when he says something like that, it's usually, I'm off to New York, or I'm off to Florida, or some other place. It's usually New York.
Not other countries or anything like that.
Well, maybe years ago he did a lot of that, but
maybe he's in the stock business. I mean, that's a hot market these days.
He's an importer.
I know, but my character doesn't know that.
Yes, he does.
Oh, he does?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Roll your sanity.
Sorry. Anyways.
Yeah, he's the head of Corbitt Importers of America. I mentioned that in the opening statements about him.
You probably did.
Yeah.
He belongs to the Businessmen's Club and
yeah. All right. So, whatever. Okay, fair enough. So, he's an importer.
Horticultural Club.
I look at Robert and I give a smile and I say he's probably just out of town on business. Are you even sure that you saw what you think you saw? I mean, we are across the street. You could have just thought you saw.
Yeah, no, I would definitely chalk it up to poor eyesight. And it's not like we can just storm across the street and say, hey, was that a hand you just dropped?
Yeah, that might be a little bit too suspicious. Or it might be crazy.
If only Clifford were here, maybe he'd have something to say.
The thing, Robert, that just won't get out of your head, that sort of sticks in your head, is the way the thing flopped when it hit the ground.
Oh.
Yeah, I mean, it could have been maybe he just brought home a fish from the market or something.
Exactly. Don't let Corbitt ruin the evening, or the afternoon. Let's just sit down and have a chat. If it continues to bother you, maybe we'll do coffee.
Yeah, I mean, if anything, maybe he would like to join us now. I mean,
he's home.
I did send him an invite. I mean, he was invited to today, so it was just a matter of he had other plans. But
yeah, well, if you'd like, I can stop over really quickly as you party on to see if he'd be interested.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. So. You know, I'll excuse myself for a moment and say, oh, very well, I will go to get Mr. Corbitt, and if anything, we can resolve this mess, you know, or this misconception of yours, and
simply keep your hands in your pockets.
Yes. So I kind of adjust my coat and, you know, or
suit
coat.
I look at Sebastian and I say, do you want me to come with you? Maybe it's best.
By all means, my friend.
Your coat?
Oh, sorry.
It's the middle of summer.
I know. I was about to correct myself. I adjust my tie then.
I stand up and I pat down my suit and I go stand with Sebastian. I'll let him take lead.
All right. Very well. Let us go off. We'll be back shortly, hopefully with Mr. Corbitt with us. So we exit and we kind of go over.
Okay. So you walk across the street. Go up onto his porch. What do you do?
I knock.
Okay, do a listen roll. Mm-hmm.
Sure.
You want me to do a listen roll too, Thom?
Sure.
All right, my listen roll is 75. I got 56.
Oh, well, okay. There you go.
What did you get, Thom?
Let me see here. What's my listen? My listen is a 65. I got a 28.
Okay. You listen. You're standing there for a couple seconds. You don't hear any footsteps coming, but you think that you hear kind of a rhythmical machine of some sort, like an air compressor. It's off in the distance. The sound might be coming from around the side of the house, or
so we don't know if it's in the house, like specifically.
Yeah.
Okay. Do you hear that?
I raise an eyebrow
It's very faint.
And I say maybe he's in the greenhouse.
Perhaps. But do you hear that sound? Or it sounds faint, but sounds like a machine, I think. I don't know. Maybe it's my imagination. I don't know. I kind of just knocked a little again, you know.
No answer.
All right. I don't know. Should we bother him, or should we just simply go back to the party?
If he's in the greenhouse after the events with Gregory, I think that we should probably just leave him alone.
I agree. Maybe he's had enough of seeing Gregory and does not want to simply see him at the party.
Yes, maybe that's why he hasn't shown up.
Oh, yes, maybe he's ignoring us, fearing for Gregory. Let us go back, then. No reason to bother him. Maybe we can check later.
Yeah, maybe we'll check later.
All right, so you head back over to the house and rejoin the party.
I'm going to share the information of the rhythmic machine noise with the rest of the party.
I sort of confirm that story.
The more you think about it, the more it really did sound kind of like an air compressor.
Okay, so it didn't sound like a saw, like a mechanical saw or anything like that?
No.
No? Okay.
Is an air compressor common around 1920s?
Sure. I mean, mechanic places, maybe garages and...
I just don't know in general, so...
I think they were, but I think it was mainly in the industrial, but I really...
Well, let's not worry about it. It's in my game.
Yeah. It's in the scenario. We're doing it.
Yes. Anyways, sorry. Regardless.
Gentlemen, was he in the greenhouse?
Really
hard? Did he have any drawers?
We did not bother to go in further because... we felt that maybe it was best to just not bother him, you know.
So what you gentlemen are telling me, that if you hear a woman screaming, you would not investigate.
Is that we would investigate that, but to be fair, maybe he just didn't want to involve himself with you so soon after the greenhouse incident.
What are you insinuating?
I'm just saying that perhaps Mr. Corbitt is just trying to keep his distance, to let the awkwardness fade away.
Well, I see. And that's how you feel.
Well, it's not how I feel, it's just how I think that perhaps maybe it's a reason why he didn't come to answer the door.
I'll wish you a good night, gentlemen. And I'll take my leave.
I thought it's lunchtime.
And no, I'll take my leave from the group.
It's now about 4 in the afternoon.
I go like this to Gregory.
Yeah.
I'm gonna go home.
I even say to Gregory like hurt. I even say, Professor, if you're going to go across the street, you may as well just take one of us.
Yes, please avoid any...
Bah, humbug!
Yes, please avoid harassing Mr. Corbitt.
You don't want another incident like last time.
Good knows, there's only a few of us around here. Last thing we need is some neighbor spat.
Thom, I'm going to slam the door. My feelings are hurt. My man feelings are hurt.
So as he closes
getting old.
Yeah, so like, so the silence fills the room, you know, I think everyone's has anyone heard of the new Pulpit magazine that came out recently?
Okay, so Gregory ends up going, are you going home?
Oh, absolutely. I've been embarrassed, damn it.
All right, so you're going home, and the rest of you are still enjoying your party. Is there any more actions or discussions other than pulp magazines? And
I think evil thoughts of the group, by the way.
You hurt my feelings, Gregory. Do you mind if I do a psychology check on Robert? Because, like I said, my character, everyone's a little like, oh, you know, it's just something. Now that I'm thinking about it after the mechanical thing, I want my character to be reassured that, like, okay, something did actually happen.
Okay, well, I'm not exactly sure how I play a psychology role on Robert to see if he's...
if he's actually unnerved.
If he's
like,
actually, yeah, because...
He is unnerved.
Is.
But perhaps give a roll to confirm it?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, go ahead. Go ahead.
Is yes. there any way... Let me see here. Oh, I got a 58. My thing is a 65. Okay.
Well, let's just say that Robert seems sincere. He did see something, and it's... Yeah, although we're all trying to laugh it off... He's obviously a little upset and disturbed by what he saw.
Okay.
Well,
even if it was just a miss, it was just too vivid.
I see.
I'm going to keep checking out the window.
So you're just seeing that sort of in his face that, yeah, he keeps looking out the window. And
okay.
It must have been something, must have been very, very realistic. I see.
Yeah, after like this long, he doesn't really, to me, my character, he thinks like, oh, he seems kind of disturbed, so that's what...
Yes, I've read many pulp novels that were frightening, but in the end, they all just fade away because they're pure nonsense, so this is, you know, this doesn't seem like that. It's like pure nonsense.
Robert, are you sure you don't want us to leave? After all, I mean, Gregory's gone, and two of our friends aren't here, and you seem to be preoccupied with what you saw. Would you just like us to go?
No, I'm okay with the company. I mean, it's just, I'm just not quite sure I trust my own, what I saw and what I didn't see.
Well, Francis is going to leave, but he says, if you need any help, you can come by the club anytime, and... If you need us to lay things off your mind, come by the club and then we'll see what will happen. And then I leave because I think he... I leave.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes. I don't know. What should we do in this case scenario? I mean, for one matter, I mean, you are clearly distressed and I feel ill to just simply leave you. And I feel, and as we tried, Mr. Corbitt would not come to the door, and I don't know if we should confronting him would be the best of options.
Well, maybe we can all agree, you know, once we get Gregory back in the loop, but you know, we can all keep an eye on his house as a unit, you know.
Yes.
Just everybody kind of keep their eyes open.
You said
now, do you see that before I leave, or is that just?
Well, didn't you already just leave?
Well, I'm assuming how the conversation flowing it was.
Yeah.
Well, I do believe that would be possible. I'd rather not snoop in other, you know, people's properties and what they're doing in their own homes, but I do believe
I heard that from my house!
I don't think keeping an extra eye on the house would hurt. You, for the record, you did say you saw a hand of a small child?
No. It looked like he was carrying two packages. and then as he was going up to his door, that, and I've noticed this before when I've had to take care of his house, that key in the door lock, it sticks a lot of times. Mm-hmm. So it looks like he was having trouble trying to get the door open, and in the process of trying to get the door open, one of those packages slipped out of his arms, and it sort of like flopped onto the top patio step there.
I see. So he had another package. Interesting. For whatever reason, I do believe keeping an eye on him would be the wisest course. I mean, we can simply go talk to him when he becomes available and simply sort it out.
Yeah, I mean, clearly I give him the benefit of the doubt, but
of course, I mean, a man such as him, I mean, well, he's able to tolerate me well enough.
The good doctor said that his doors were locked, right? That's what the word around the neighborhood was, is that all the doors were locked and that there was a padlock on the greenhouse?
Well, there was a padlock on the greenhouse, yeah.
Why would there be a padlock on the greenhouse? Like, this is the first... Gregory is the first incident of us ever annoying him or going onto his property. Why lock it?
Well,
actually, you've all lived here for years. Are you sure it's the first time that Gregory hasn't tried?
Yes. Well, I mean, perhaps this isn't the first incident. Perhaps
is the first time I heard of it. But yes. Maybe it's not the first time it's happened.
Yes.
I'm going out and buying a padlock and putting it on my door.
It's the first time I've been. What I mean, damn it.
Yes. Yes. Well, getting the benefit of the doubt, I do believe. Well, for whatever reason, I do believe it'd be wise enough to simply leave it be and keep an eye out. I do, and perhaps, you know, tomorrow we can see if he's more free. Would that be all right, gentlemen, to meet again? And perhaps we can all sort this out together, us three.
I stand up and I say, let's meet tomorrow. We'll discuss it with everyone. How does that sound? That sounds good?
Of course. I wish to stop by and make a few business things before the day ends, so that'd be wise. Would you think it'd be all right, Robert?
Yes, sure, absolutely.
Of course. If you need me, simply keep an eye out for me, and I will gladly be of service.
Yes, I have to... I'm going to go make a telephone call, so...
Of course. I'm off to do my business, then.
Okay. Hey, Thom. Patrick.
Sorry.
Oh, you were gonna say something?
I was gonna say what I wanted to do.
Go ahead.
I was gonna say, Thom. So, like, basically, the party's kind of more or less over, right? And we can do our actions, right?
Yes.
I was actually hoping to talk to Cliff, our private guy, like at least in character.
He's not here.
I know. But can we kind of like? But basically, what I wanted to do was kind of talk to him and see if he'd be willing to kind of introduce me to his police contacts.
Yeah, I guess so.
Like just to talk to them about the jackal.
Sure.
Okay. And smart. Well, because I'm immediately going to go home and I'm going to ring up the Arkham Police Station and I will our local beat cop. I'll click on his extension.
Beep, beep, okay, beep. There's probably at this time there's an operator, not really an operator, but you know, a police operator.
Yeah. Then she puts me through.
Okay. Darn, I gave him some names. I told him he could make up names as he went along since. All right, you speak, Officer Bill Hancock.
Okay.
Is the guy who's usually in your neighborhood.
Okay.
I gotta remember that.
Yeah. Yes.
Is that the one I'm being introduced to as well, or is that...
Well, you're still on your way. The phone call happens faster.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Even in the 1920s, it's still happening faster.
So I wait for him to pick up the phone, and we'll have a conversation, I guess.
This is Officer Bill.
Bill, it's William Robinson.
How are you doing?
I'm doing okay. I'm calling because Robert says he just saw Mr. Corbitt with an arm.
What do you mean, saw him with an arm?
We were all at the party, and Robert just happened to be looking outside, and he saw Corbitt pull up into his driveway and walk up to the door, open the door, and he says a package fell out, and Robert says that he thought it was an arm.
That sounds ridiculous. It was probably a fish.
I know. But just humor me, please. And is there any word on the jackal recently? I know that we've seen some news clippings from last week, but has anything else turned up?
I don't personally. I'm not working on that case at all. I think you'd probably want to talk to
Francis.
Francis Hancock, his evil twin brother that works with him at the
police. You'll probably want to talk to Wade Morton. He's the lead detective on that.
Do you think he'd mind if I talked with him?
No, if you think you might have something, or...
Well, I mean, it's a long shot, but, you know, Robert seems pretty certain what he saw is what he saw, and you know Robert, he's not one to just spout off his mouth.
Well, where exactly did he see this? I mean, you said you were at a party?
We were at Robert's house, right across the street from Corbett's.
And Mr. Corbitt was there with an arm?
Robert says he saw Mr. Corbitt walk from his car up to his door, open his door, but you know that lock is stubborn, so he had to force it open. Arm.
So he saw this from his front yard, or?
The living room window, so just across the street.
That's quite a distance. If it makes you feel better, I can go by and ask Mr. Corbitt.
Yeah, and another thing is that when me and Sebastian went over to his house to just see if everything was all right, Corbitt wasn't answering the door, and we both distinctively heard what sounded like an air compressor.
Well, he's got a huge property. He does have farming equipment and stuff like that. I don't see that there's anything unusual in any of that.
Well, I'm just letting you know.
I don't know the man. I know the man only from, you know, I see him in town, and he's at business meetings, and I know where he works, but... For all we know, he could have a big old freezer. A lot of people do. That might have been the air compressor you heard.
You think so?
A lot of people have fridges on their back porches. Of course, not in your neighborhood, but
no, not in our neighborhood. Well, thanks. Thanks, Bill. If you can just give me the number for Detective Wade, I'll give him a call when I'm good and ready.
All right. And he gives you the number.
All right. I take down the number. And I wish him a good afternoon.
Actually, he actually says to you, too, he says, you know, you can try his extension, but he's out and about a lot of times. And sometimes it's better to catch him when he's here.
All right. Well, you know, we have Investigator Clifford in our neighborhood. You know him, right?
Clifford Porter?
Yeah.
Clifford Porter. Okay, yeah. Yeah, we've met.
Yeah, maybe we'll come down and we'll have a chat with him.
All right.
Well, have a good rest of your afternoon.
You got it.
All right, hang up.
All right, so you
what
hang up.
What a nice gentleman.
They're all nice.
Yeah.
That's kind of dumb.
Yeah.
You should have named one Officer Friendly.
And now he's going to go to Mr. Corbitt and ask him.
Of course.
Yeah, I was expecting that.
How wonderful.
Uh-oh. Yeah, I'm off the hot list or the hot box.
But no, guys, I just realized, I just screwed us up. He's going to know that one of us saw it, and he's going to take us all down. He's going to pick us off one by one.
Hey, I saw that in a movie.
I think it was called Halloween.
So, next move.
All right.
Let's see. Corey, what are you doing?
Well, I am... Well, I'm leaving, and I decided to go back to my house and kind of watch the outcome from my front window.
Okay, you can definitely see Corbett's and Perry's and Miss Clark's from where you are. It's a little over to the side.
That's what basically I'm going to do. I'm just sitting back and watching the action unfold.
With your binoculars, okay.
With my binoculars.
Creepy. let's see. Thom, what are you going to do? You were on the phone.
I imagine that I'm going to walk back to Robert's house and let him know that I did call Bill. And I let him know everything.
Robert, are you doing anything before he gets there?
No, I don't think so.
All right. We'll get back to that in a second. Let's see. Sebastian, what are you doing?
Sorry. you glitched out for a second there.
Oh, Sebastian, what are you doing?
Oh yeah. So I said, like I said before, I'm going to I was going to go to Clifford, Cliff, and basically I was just asking, hey, you know, could you introduce me to some of your police friends and stuff? Because I'm writing a pulp novel. I'm trying to get a better, idea of the police and maybe learn a little bit more about the Jackal situation.
In that case, Clifford's like, yeah, you know, I meant to be going to talk to some of the detectives myself. Let's go.
Oh, yes, please.
So you're going to be doing that.
Yes.
Gregory, what are you up to?
I'm minding my own damn business like everybody else would be doing.
So you're yourself into a stupor.
Yes, damn it.
He's sulking.
I forget, Gregory. Is your character married?
No, I'm not married. No.
Was he?
No.
Okay.
Yeah.
So he's married. He's married to his work.
I am. I'm married to my work. Yes.
Okay.
His garden. His garden is his love.
My garden. My victory garden. World War II.
Well, in your hospital teaching, yeah.
Well, yes. I have the Buxomus redhead in the library that I work with.
All right. So let's see, where were we? Let's go to Thom, you're going back over to Robert's house. Yeah, I'm sorry, not Thom. William, you're going back over to.
Please don't tell me that Bill is already, is pulling up as I'm walking into Perry's house, because I'll be like, oh no.
No, to be honest, Bill's probably not. He's going to do it when he's in the neighborhood.
Oh no!
He really doesn't want to bother somebody over something that's obviously a mistake.
Yeah.
What day is this? Is this like a weekend?
This was Sunday.
This is Sunday.
Oh, okay.
I think what I'll do is I'll go to the university to cool off, and I'll take my little motor car, my little horseless carriage, and.
Okay.
And just set up, make sure everything's set up that's already set up, because I did that on Friday.
Right.
But that's what I'm going to do.
Okay. William, you're with Robert?
Yeah, I'll knock on Robert's door.
All right.
Yes, William.
Can I come in? I just wanted to talk to you for just a second.
Please.
No,
please.
Stay on the porch.
No, they'll see me. all right. Sure. Yeah. I'll have a drink, and I just sit down in a chair, and I
watch you pour the drink, and I say, I called Bill, the beat cop that comes by here every now and then.
Okay.
I let him know what you saw.
Oh. Uh-oh. Am I going to be in trouble here, or...?
I don't think so. He thinks it's a big mistake, and frankly, I mean, I think it could be, but then again, with this jackal running around, do you really think what you saw was an arm?
I'm trying to get my head around it. I mean, it doesn't... My eyes are telling me what I saw, and yet I just find it hard to believe. I can't make the two meet in my brain.
But do you believe that what you saw was an arm?
I think if I knew 100% without a doubt, I would probably go to the police immediately. I mean, clearly somebody doesn't just walk into the house with an arm and then I just sit back and do nothing. But no. I don't trust my own self well enough to say, you know, to cause a fury like that.
Well, the neighborhood has... Corbett's always been off, as we have discussed. I don't think that we should use electroshock therapy on him, but I agree with everyone's thoughts, and he does seem a little off, a little bit reclusive.
Yeah, definitely strange, I'm going to say that.
And you're the only one that's been in his house.
Yeah, I never noticed anything out of the ordinary. I mean, he's a super clean guy and everything.
You've never been really far into his house either. You've put his stuff on the little table in his cloakroom and sort of around the corner.
No, I'm kidding. Yeah, I wouldn't do that.
No. And you see that, like I told you, it's very neat and clean, as if his wife was there taking care of it. But apparently he's a neat freak too, so...
Well, good for him, I guess. well, it's... With the whole jackal thing going on and with, you know, Gregory running around doing his thing, I'm worried about the neighborhood. I'm worried about us. You're my friends. And, you know, I didn't take time off of work so that way I could, you know, watch my friends get into trouble and get hurt. So, you know, I thought I should let Bill know.
Yeah, it's probably for the best.
This is some deep character development.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, deep bonding. He could be coming around to talk to you. I don't know. But I'm going to talk to a Detective Wade at the police department as soon as I see Clifford. And we're going to go talk about the jackal because... I don't know. Something just feels off. You see an arm, the jackal's running around, and then, of course, there's the possibility of the escaped inmates. I don't know. Something just feels off.
Well, maybe you see me and Clifford kind of, you know, are riding out or walking that way, so maybe you could join us then.
I don't know. Would I see them? I'm in there.
Well,
I was just
actually looking at the map, and from... Robert's house, you'd walk in completely the opposite direction. You'd walk by Bielmer's and Carter's and then to your house, whereas they're in the other direction, McLean, Clark, Porter, and Hall.
Okay, so yeah.
Probably not.
So yeah, I'll just assume that eventually I'm going to run into Clifford or I'll go to Clifford's house and talk to him, but he won't be there, blah, blah, blah.
When you go, let me know. I'd like to go with you.
Yeah, I'll let you know. We'll stop by.
Yep.
Well, I thought I should let you know. Yes, thanks for the drink. I stand up, and I walk to the door, and I guess I head home.
Okay. So let's do Sebastian and Cliff going to see Wade Morton.
Sweet.
You guys go into town. And you head over to the police station, and what do you do? You can talk. There's a receptionist in the front.
Yes.
In fact, you know her name is Amy.
Mm, awesome. Like in the police station, you mean?
Yeah.
Okay. How do I know her name, or is that just Cliff knows her name?
It would might be that little tag that says Amy in front of her.
Well,
just a clue.
That's one thing, but you've been in here more than once, so you know, ask whatever for whatever reason. People in neighborhoods where nothing ever happens bother the police more than anybody else.
That is true.
I resemble that remark.
All right, so she directs you. She points you back to a desk, and you see a detective there. And it just so happens that he's just unwrapped a sandwich, and he's biting into it as you come up to his desk. And so he's like. Mm-hmm.
Please, if you'd like, we can come back. We can wait till you finish your meal, or you can eat well. Or...
And he's like, no. Go ahead and sit down.
Oh, thank you. I'm Sebastian Carter. This is Cliff Reports.
Well, no, he knows Cliff.
Yeah. So basically, he's like, I know who Cliff is. Okay.
So he's like, so Cliff, what do you guys want to talk about?
Well, we were hoping to know more about the Jackal situation.
The Jackal situation. Be honest, we don't know much. We it all started about 6 months ago.
Yes, I've read the papers.
People's pets been disappearing, and they've been turning up here and there in other parts of town, mutilated. But to be perfectly honest, it doesn't look like they were mutilated by animals.
Well, they look like
there have been, you know, that a knife was used to.
Yes, I've read the report. Yes. Mm. Very grotesque. So you really have no idea or have got any leads on who might be doing these acts?
Nothing solid, no. There was that kid, but how was his name? Tomazowski. But that really didn't go anywhere. We didn't want to harass the kid if he wasn't involved.
I see. But I mean, one thing that's been bothering me and my current neighborhood friends is that we've been worried that that the Jackal might be striking out at people next. Has there been anyone gone missing at all?
Not that I know of. No.
I see. I mean, this is again, it is a bit frightening as we, you know, as such a man going out committing such vile acts. It's.
Well, I don't think you have much to worry about. It's there hasn't been a case in the last few weeks, and I think that people are being careful with their pets. It's probably just some kids doing some weird shit.
Well, they are children after all. What they, you know, they don't know any better.
Well, it's in this. It's the age in which we live in. I know when I was a young person, we were all good, healthy, church-going people, and now they're kind of all the kids think about nowadays is sex, and they've turned from their Christian beliefs and
yes, indeed,
into all sorts of weird stuff.
Yes,
the reason why we first suspected Tom Mazowski was the tattoos. Well, he's got tattoos, and that's
tattoos.
He ain't a sailor.
Tattoos? You said he's not a sailor, but tattoos of what?
Just different things. It's certainly, you know, there's no anchors on there or just weird shit.
I see. I feel I don't know what else to ask or if I can be any of help in this case scenario. I mean, God knows I wouldn't want to see any more pets die.
Well, you probably... Since you're curious about it, you probably checked the library for past articles and stuff. There's not much.
Yes, I've checked out the library itself. Yes, sadly there isn't much. Well, I do wish you luck in your investigation.
Well, if you think you've seen anything, or if any pets go missing, be sure and tell us.
You know, you know, kind of, you know, stand up with Cliff and like, we will. And before I go, one more thing. Again, this may be nothing, but I remember perhaps seeing, perhaps a dead animal corpse around you know, one of my neighbors' home, Mr. Corbitt. Maybe perhaps it was nothing, perhaps it died naturally, but again, maybe it's something worth looking into.
Is that Bernard Corbitt?
Yes, it was on his property somewhere. Perhaps, maybe if you go talk to him, he'd be willing to let you look around.
Sure. He's got a large property, but what sort of animal did you see?
I don't remember. Maybe a dog?
An elephant? A buffalo? Water buffalo, maybe?
Nobody's reported any missing dogs in your neighborhood.
Maybe it was a stray, or maybe it was, I don't know, something else.
Well, I'll write it down.
Yes,
he writes it down. And
again, perhaps it was just a stray that passed away, or perhaps it was just a raccoon. I could be mistaken, after all.
Well, you know, we are in a bit of a rural area, and we find, you know, there's dead animals.
Yeah, of course.
They're usually wild animals.
Yeah. Do the pets the jackal kill always end up in the same place?
No. It seems like they're just sort of randomly tossed aside somewhere.
I see. And anything done to the corpse specifically? Like, if I were to see a dead animal, is there anything I should be looking out for to call you on? After all, I do not want to bother you for every dead animal I see.
There's usually parts missing, but
No, then it was probably a stray, because I don't think I saw any parts. But still, maybe it'd be worth looking into. All right. Well, thank you, officer. Me and Clifford will thank you for your time. We will call you if we see anything suspicious or anything.
All right. You have a nice day.
You have a nice day. Enjoy your sandwich.
Oh, my sandwich.
Yes. Yes.
Interesting. Okay. What would everybody... Okay, everybody has done what they've done. Now, what else do you want to do? It's still fairly early in the day.
Let's see here. So we've already looked at the whatever available clippings of the jackal that are, correct?
Correct. You found everything that you probably could find on the jackal. Once again, the jackal is... This is current news, so it's...
Yes.
There's probably... Now, I don't have a clipping to show you, but there's probably a couple of things, right, you know, 6 months ago that were like pets going missing, no explanation, and then...
Yeah, yeah. So basically, like, the first sightings of, you know, pets going missing.
Right.
Yes.
Have you seen this pet?
Yes. Yes, very interesting. I'm kind of thinking, Sebastian's kind of walking around thinking of what he can do.
Well, and Sebastian is a library person, so.
Yeah. Perhaps I can stop by perhaps the university library, talk to some old friends. Could I find a list of people who lost their pets?
The police probably do have a list, but they're not just going to hand it to you.
Yeah, no, definitely not. I believe the next logical step is to buy a gun.
Well, I wouldn't be surprised if you owned a gun, but...
Yeah, well, again, a nice shotgun wouldn't hurt to have for protection against such a dangerous figure.
Okay.
Maybe I'll go shopping for one.
Cool. Anything else from anybody?
I'm going to just stay on.
I'm still going like this.
But you don't see anything.
Yeah. No. I'll get nothing more, you know.
All right. Well, let's say it. We move to the next day, Monday, unless anybody of you have some objections or you want to do something.
Sorry, go ahead.
No, I'll let you go.
I was just going to say, I think Sebastian would buy that gun.
All right. He buys a gun.
Yes, a shotgun, please.
You got it.
Yep, and I want a bazooka and a tank and a mounted machine gun and one of those.
And a RPG.
They don't carry those at S Smart.
Damn it.
But they do carry the Winchester.
Yes. Yes.
Yes. Shop Smart. Shop S Smart.
Yes. All right.
Was there anything anybody else wanted to do?
Yeah, I'd like to, in the evening, before I retire, I'm going to stay up late and put this whole mess to bed. I'm mad at my neighbors for insulting me. And if I can catch, with all this rigmarole with Mr. Corbitt, and they're worried about me being a busybody, I'm going to show them what a busybody can do. I would like to sit 2 blocks away in my vehicle on the corner reading.
Sorry?
Oh, I think he froze.
Uh-oh.
Or maybe he's just sitting on the corner in his vehicle.
Pause for dramatic effect.
Richard, we lost you.
Yeah, he's gone.
Well, we are not having much luck tonight with the computers, are we?
Yeah.
No.
Mr. Yeah. Corbett got him.
Yes.
Well, he was the first one.
Yes.
We'll come back to Richard if.
Yep.
See what he had to say.
Sorry.
But until then, we'll jump to the next day.
All right.
Robert. The only thing you notice is what you kind of notice every day, and that's that Mr. Corbitt leaves the house at promptly 8:30, which he does Monday through Friday anyway to go to work. And I suppose if you guys are looking, Mr. McLean, Mr. Porter, and Mr. Hall see his car go by.
Yep.
Who did we lose now?
I think it was
Richard. Yeah, Richard actually dropped.
Oh, okay.
Probably trying to re-log in again.
All right. So you've seen him leave for work.
Does he have an office then nearby?
Yes, he does.
Okay.
He has an office in the middle of town. He runs Corbitt Importers of America. He works 9 to 5 every day, and you've rarely ever seen him sick. And he takes he doesn't work on the weekends.
Do we know what sort of imports?
Yes, you do, because a lot of times, when he has asked you to watch over his place, he asks you if you need anything. He imports various things from the Orient. Furniture, carpets, tea if you want it, are objects to art, whatever is going on the market at the moment.
Mostly Oriental though, or Asian?
Yeah, he's got pretty well, yeah, from Asia, from India, from places like that.
Okay.
He's never done anything from like South America or...
So, like, his office would be like a shop that would be open to the public where they could just walk in and look around?
Not usually. It's all he does is the import part. He usually has clients that purchase stuff. Now, they might have shops.
I see. Okay.
So,
he's the middleman.
He handles the importing part of it.
Okay.
But he can get whatever you want. pretty much. So if you fancy something, he gave Margaret a pretty little oriental vase with the orchids in it. Mm-hmm. So when he gives gifts, they're usually something like that.
Hmm. Okay. Well, I could, I don't know if I want to go there yet, but.
Well, I think Sebastian would like to try out a few practice shots with that shotgun he just bought.
Okay. That's fine. Let me, you guys seem quiet. Let me, why don't you do an idea roll?
All right.
Okay. Do you want me to do an idea roll, or did
I'll
I see
all
the
do idea rolls?
Okay, so I saw the car leave.
Yeah, my idea is 80, and I got a 16.
Wow, good.
I think I made it with a 36.
Okay, well, it's just I just wanted one of you, any of you that made it. I just want to say that Mr. Corbitt has been one who's lived in this town for a long time, and you know some of the stuff about him. You know that he lost his wife over a decade ago, and you know that he inherited the business from his father. Newspapers probably have stuff about all that.
To the library!
Yeah.
We're off.
I mean, the question is, what do you really know about this guy?
Yeah. Sure, I go to the library. Why not? Anyone want to come with me?
Sure.
Yes, please.
Yeah, I'll go to the library, too. Who really?
I mean, you need the librarian, damn it. Or the ex-librarian.
All right. The library bros.
Yes.
Da-da-da-da. Yes, to the library.
To the library mobile. Da-da-da-da.
Okay. Yes, okay, yes. So I'm going to roll a library check. Is that fine?
Yeah, go ahead and do a library check.
Okay, is this for like knowing more about Mr. Corbett and stuff?
Well, I assume you're looking through newspapers then. You're not going to find
that's what I'm doing.
Yeah, do you mind if I join on that?
I'll join too.
Oh, well, we'll let one person each time. So.
All right.
12.
Just keeping. You got a 12?
12 out of 25. So
that's pretty good.
I know. If only I got that on something else that I really needed it on. Whatever.
Well, as you're looking through, William, this is what you find.
Okay. Let's find it. You want me to read it out loud?
Yeah.
No, read it quietly. No,
notice the date, too.
Yes.
Oh, I noticed the date. Local businessman killed in accident. Oh, wow, okay. It was learned today that Theodore Corbitt, owner of Corbitt Importers of America, is dead. Victim of a tragic accident while vacationing in India, Corbitt, while in the company of his son Bernard, died in a fall while the two were traveling through the high mountains of Nepal. According to authorities, the two men were on a hiking trip when they were set upon by a group of bandits known to frequent the area. While being pursued down the mountainside, the elder Corbitt apparently lost his footing and fell to his death. His son managed to escape, eventually making it to safety. The elder Corbett's body has not been located, and authorities fear that it may be lost, possibly consumed by the wild dogs that roam the mountain. Theodore Corbitt is survived by his wife, Elaine, and his one son, Bernard. At this time, it is not known if Bernard Corbett will take over management of Corbitt Importers. June 5th, 1909.
It's about 14 years ago.
So,
okay.
Theories, everybody?
I have some theories.
So, Bernard Corbett is our current friend, right?
Like, yes.
Okay. Well, wow, this is something exactly from my pulp novel, but I have to say, I never knew this about our neighbor.
Well, not only that, but that was 14 years ago. Like, yes.
Think what that does to a man.
14 years ago, he lost his wife 10, so he's had a really hard couple past two decades.
Indeed.
I don't know. Maybe he's I shouldn't say the word, but cursed?
Well, I wouldn't say cursed, but I still don't... I mean, from what I see of him, he does seem, like, well-adjusted.
That's for sure.
I mean...
But...
Let's pause for just a moment. Richard, sorry, I'm glad to see you back.
Yes!
We went to the next day. Is there anything that you were going to do?
The only thing I was going to do is if I could catch Mr. Corbitt leaving his house a couple of blocks, I was going to follow him to figure out where he's getting his formula, perhaps, and I was going to shadow him. But I didn't want to do it in front of my nosy neighbors because I respect people's property. I want you all to know that.
Well, oh, okay.
On Sunday, Mr. Corbitt did not leave the house again once he got home. The next day, a few of the others noticed him going to work, but that's not unusual. He goes to work every day of the week, Monday through Friday. He leaves at 8:30, comes home about 5:30. Mm-hmm. Keeps regular hours. So now it's the next day, and they've decided to go to the library to look up more stuff on Mr. Corbitt.
Should we inform Gregory? Like, Gregory's here now. Let's tell him everything.
Yeah, I mean, you can say that Gregory just showed up at the library for no particular reason.
Yeah, I'm talking to that buxom as redhead. Yeah.
Okay. So, Corbitt, 14 years ago, Corbitt and his father were in Nepal. His father died, and Corbitt somehow survived the whole ordeal with a bunch of bandits. So,
that's not strange.
Well, it seems something right out of my pulp novel. I'm surprised he hasn't become an Avenger or some mystic goo-do-gooder. sorry, bad joke. Regardless, this does make me ask a few questions about the man.
What such as?
Go ahead.
I was just simply wondering how has he remained so well adjusted. Remains a shock to me. I mean, perhaps he's hiding his pain, but regardless.
Or what if it wasn't bandits that killed his father in the first place?
Maybe Corbitt or Bernard, whatever his name is, killed his father by
sabotaging him?
By sabotaging him.
He could have easily have murdered him in the mountains of Nepal and no one would know about it. Corbitt Importers of America is a huge business.
Well, I don't know. It just seems so unlike him. But that's perhaps we've known him. I've known him so long that it just seems so unlikely of him. But
well,
still,
there's one thing we can do is the next tomorrow to give us the maximum of time. We can, if when he's gone, we can break into his elves and see what's actually going on.
No,
we have no cause yet to break into his home just because of this pay article.
You can never break into anybody's home. That's just un-American. That's like
well, I'm French, you damn it!
French, not Frank.
That's the reason why. You sneaky people, you.
As much as I hate to look at Gregory and say that he's right about something involving going onto someone's property and snooping around. Gregory's
yeah, you
right.
shouldn't do that. You should never do that.
It's completely
only
un-American.
If you see a bunch of, exactly, because if you see a bunch of young kids breaking into something and then leave behind a universal key such as
pliers,
bolt cutters. Thank you, bolt cutters, and then some French man comes behind you and accuses you of everything, and then your so-called good friends believe the French man and accuse you of being a busybody. I thought you were all loony.
We never accused you of being a busybody, but Gregory, let's be honest.
Let's be honest. There were no kids. Why would kids be in our neighborhood running around?
Look, ask them, because I don't know why they had broken that lock off of with the bolt
regardless, covers. Regardless, it does
I
not make
I was the good American.
Well, regardless, it doesn't make it any easier for Mr. Corbitt to talk to you about it. So perhaps
well,
he's just simply waiting.
Somebody just didn't run his French mouth so much.
Hey.
Regardless, is this the only article we have of Mr. Corbitt?
This is a library, guys.
Yeah, you should keep it down.
Yes.
Keep it down.
I've been in the library for a long time. I probably do it on instinct.
Who got that article?
That was
me.
William.
All right. Patrick, why don't you go ahead and you're rolling to see if you can find any articles.
57, so I pass. My library use is 85.
Jeez.
Okay.
I do this for a living. I'm goddamn good at it.
You find this.
All right, what do you got here? Corbitt, Lynn Ann Myers, age 22, died in childbirth in her home. A graduate of Pierpoint School, Miss Corbett was married to a local businessman, Bennett Corbett, 2 years ago. Funeral services for both mother and child will be held Saturday afternoon at St. Paul's Church in Arkham. Miss Corbett is survived by Edward and Shirley Myers and her husband, Bennett Corbett, of President of Corbett Importers of America.
Oh, wait.
Note the date.
1911. 1911, May 6th.
Two years.
Wow, I never knew that was that close of a span of time. I assumed maybe perhaps by at least a few years, but this seems close.
So he obviously wanted to kill. I'm talking in this in a low voice. Obviously, he had something to do with the father. Like he wouldn't take his father's business so fast.
Well, but it was a theory. We don't know if it's really what happened.
It could have all been just circumstantial.
It is circumstantial.
Well,
all right, Frenchie, listen up, buddy.
Regardless,
this is a library.
Please.
This is circumstantial evidence.
Well, regardless, we can't simply assume that Corbett killed both his wife and father.
That's ludicrous. Not to be confused with Super Shirker Chris, which has not been invented yet.
Hey, I have my own theories, and I think he killed both his parent or his father and his wife.
You know what? He would have been caught. We're Americans. We're smart. We're smarter than French people.
Indeed. Regardless, I've read the Black Shadow was French, or thought was French volunteer. Well, point is, let us not stoop to insulting each other.
Frenchie.
Yeah.
There has to be more articles somewhere in this library about Corbett. If we can find more, maybe it'll explain what Robert saw.
Yeah, why don't you go on that end of the camera?
Why don't we let Robert take a look, see if he can find anything? Do a library rule.
Sure. Maybe something about his business. Library. Yeah, 50. Wow.
And 09. A bunch of kids. Francis.
09.
A bunch of kids.
You got 09, huh?
Yep.
All right. Well, you do a rather extensive look through, and you don't find anything about his business except that, you know, local businessman, importing stuff from Asia, and it just, you know, saying something nice about the stuff that he's bringing in, the quality. But then you finally run across this, which is, I believe, the same date as the obituary, or maybe the day after.
Let us see.
Yes, let us see.
Go ahead and read it, Robert.
Nurse hospitalized after accident in patient's home. Professional nurse, Miss Mona Dunlap, was admitted to Central Sanitarium yesterday following an accident that took place in a patient's home. Her condition was diagnosed as serious. Miss Dunlap, hired by Mr. and Mrs. Bernard Corbitt to help with Miss Corbett's confinement, apparently suffered a stroke while attempting to deliver the Corbett's baby unassisted. Mr. Corbitt returned from his office Wednesday afternoon to find Nurse Dunlap unconscious and his wife and infant son dead due to complications of birth. Doctors at the sanitarium say the woman has yet to regain consciousness and it may be some time before the full extent of her injuries are known. May 6th, 1911.
Jesus, so
it's a misprint.
Well, wow.
It's a misprint.
This That's woman.
All that it is. It's thrown in the paper. It has to be.
Well, three people, and yeah, this one right after Corbett's wife, and yet this woman suffers a stroke. That's
oh my goodness! People suffer strokes. I work in a hospital. I see things like this. People die in childbirth.
I'm not denying it.
But we're simply separate incidents happen around the sky. There has to be something going on.
Well, not well. I
yes, your imaginations are running away.
Yes, I simply am noting the extraordinary coincidence of a woman having a stroke the same time a woman is having a childbirth
a
and dying. With yes,
that's common. But,
yes, and I understand the stress, and perhaps stress was the thing that caused it. But still, nevertheless, such a horrible incident.
It's horrible that you're digging skeletons out of people's closets. That's like going on somebody's property.
Wait a minute.
Yeah,
wait a
minute. Gregory, going on people's property.
Oh, don't you, look, I told you about the muse.
Library, shh.
What if...
I'm the librarian. Now I've told you, be quiet.
Central Hospital just flooded and all the mental patients had to leave? That's where she was admitted,
sanitarium.
Right?
Sanitarium.
Yes.
Yeah. Sanitarium.
Perhaps.
Not all the patients, just on one
perhaps
wing.
Perhaps we should go see, is it Miss Dunlop?
She had to have worked close if she was inside the house. The only other person that we know of who's been inside the house is Robert, and Robert has only been in maybe the front room in the closet. That's it.
That's kind
now
of
just
scary.
To sort of just to sort of clarify, it's not unusual for a family to have a midwife come in and the baby be born in the house.
Well, yeah, no, that's something I don't think would be unnatural.
It's not unnatural. It's just the fact that she was in the house.
Yeah, and suffered a stroke at the same time. You know, Corbett's wife died in childbirth and along with his child. It just seems I'd hate to go and just simply talk to this woman to continue digging into Mr. Corbett's past regard.
We had to take into account what Robert saw.
Yes, that's what I agree with.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Let's go outside.
Yes. So we're outside. So I go. Well, I don't feel right doing this to simply talk to a woman and perhaps bring out something very tragic to the man. For whatever reason.
Obviously, something is going on with Mr. Corbett, and I want to figure it out.
Why don't you ask him? Why don't you say ask him?
Well, you go ask him about his recipe. Is he going to give it to you?
Well,
he would until some French man brought some stuff up and accused me of being nosy, I am clearly not.
Yes.
Gregory is right. We should just... why don't we just ask? And if he is reclusive, then he's reclusive. But if something is off about him, then we go talk to the midwife. Yes. I think that Robert's right. I think that we should just be straight with him. He's our neighbor. You know, maybe Robert saw a fish. Maybe he did. Maybe he saw an arm. We don't know. The only thing that we're going to do...
I'm getting to the point where I think that he actually saw that hand, but I really think we should...
You'd believe anything was written from like a pulp dime store novel, wouldn't you?
That's...
No, Gregory, that's no. No need to. I kind of like get in the middle of that. I'm so big. Okay, let's leave it alone, guys.
Yes. Enough of this. Let us simply call it a day for now. Can we at least do that? I think we have too much excitement in our nerves, and perhaps a day, you know, at our homes, we'll sort it out in the morning.
Well, fine. We got together to talk about Mr. Corbitt. So why don't we've talked about Mr. Corbitt? Why don't we went and talk to him?
It is
still the middle of the day.
Yes. I know. I'm saying when he arrives.
If he is,
we have a lot of deaths centered around Mr. Corbitt.
Exactly.
So if we do go and confront him, we're definitely tipping our hand, and we all could probably be in danger.
Let's just simply keep it to ourselves and let us not bring up the death of his wife. If you are going to talk to him, simply pertain about his partial. Nothing more, nothing less.
I think he's gonna
deny everything. He's gonna deny everything that we bring up.
We have no foundational evidence that whatever he was holding was a hand to begin with.
If it was a fish, he'll show us the fish. It's that simple.
Yes. We can go home. Let us get some air. Let's calm down a bit. And then perhaps if you'd like, you can talk to him yourselves. I would like to leave the man alone.
I would leave him alone, because then if we snoop around, he's going to be looking around, and I could possibly get killed.
Why would he kill you?
He's our neighbor. We've lived beside him for years. We went to the same high school, for God's sake.
Yes, different years, though, but still. Regardless, I do think that perhaps we should just simply leave Mr. Corbitt alone at the moment, or at least if we are going to chat with him, simply pertain about the partial. We've clearly dug in more than we should have. I do think that.
I agree 100% with that last statement. But I think instead of going to Mr. Corbitt, we should just go to check up on the other lead that we have.
What lead?
We're not conducting an investigation.
We're not police.
No. We're simply concerned neighbors. I'm concerned for our safety. If Robert did see an arm, what's it him stopping him from coming for us? But if it was a fish, then it was nothing more. And if it was a fish, he'll just show it to us and we'll move on.
If it was an arm, he would have killed all of you. By now.
You would have killed you too, you know.
All right.
Oh, he couldn't. You know what? I'm not French.
William, should we let them
leave my name out of it that I saw this hand?
Yeah.
Yes. Oh, all of a sudden, the person that sees everything wants to back out. I find that a little fishy.
Does anybody have any skills with lock picking by any chance?
No,
because then you would be... Oh, the French guy does, because he's a criminal now. Maybe you were there before I was, and those kids, and maybe you were the kids that I thought I saw.
I just had a thought that instead of, you know, we don't want to violate his home, maybe we could investigate his office, find out who his clients are.
Well, for what reason, though? We have no reason to be going this far into investigation of him. We haven't even bothered to ask him about or even talk to him at all.
Robert's concerns are his own, because what he thinks he saw was an arm. And who are we to say that he didn't see it?
I'm not claiming that he perhaps saw it or didn't. I'm just simply stating that we're going in so fast, so deep, without really having proper reasoning other than maybe he saw it, maybe he didn't, without proper clarification on it first.
Let me get this straight. You're
going to go up to a man and say, "Pardon me, did we see you just carry your hand into your house?"
I'm not saying do that, but perhaps be more nuanced. Perhaps ask him if he's had fish for dinner. Perhaps ask him if he, perhaps simply go about it the right way.
Why don't you have a ham sandwich?
You know,
did you have a hand sandwich?
I am not saying we ask him about whether or not he had a hand. I simply say we should ask him more cautiously.
Well, ask more questions about him, he'll come after. But I'm not gonna talk to him. That's for sure.
Well, okay, hold on. What if? As I said in the group, okay, hold on, everybody, calm down. What if we didn't look at Robert? If we didn't break into his house, we're respectful businessmen.
We never did.
We're respectful businessmen. What if we just go to the office and talk about purchasing an item? We learn about him from there. He's clearly involved in his work. Maybe he'll open up if we talk about work.
That sounds like a good idea.
Okay. Fair enough.
That's good. All right. Now, before we go, I point at Gregory with a big finger. No more French. And I point at Francis. No more being a coward. He's our neighbor, and we're all friends. And if one of our friends is in danger, then we're all in danger.
Right here.
Well said. Well said, Mr. Williams.
All right.
Absolutely.
Yes.
So, are you all going to head over there to his office?
Let's go to his office.
Yes.
I'm hesitant, but I will go. But I'm keeping my eye on Gregory. That's for sure.
Okay.
Pick you up and force you inside. No more of this. We're all going. We're all together.
Actually, I will not go.
Oh, wait a second.
What?
How come? Chicken now?
I just feel perhaps I don't know. I just feel uncomfortable simply. I'll wait outside.
All right.
Oh, how brave.
I thought you wanted to have this for your novel there.
Yes, but I feel, simply put, I think it would be better to leave him alone.
If Sebastian wants to wait outside, Sebastian can wait outside.
Well, if Sebastian's going to wait outside, I'm going to wait outside because not pointing any fingers, but someone as a little uncomfortable.
Oh, very well. I'll actually go inside because clearly I feel that if I leave you to it, then perhaps worse things can be said.
All right. Well,
guess I am forced to at this point. Very well.
Let's go inside.
Proceed.
Now, Thom, I'm going to break off from the group because I'm going to take my own vehicle. They did mention some things. I'm going to take that name, and I'm going to the hospital instead. And I'm going to let these neighbors do their thing with Mr. Corbitt. Because I'm not going to upset him any more than I have because of somebody that's unmentionable.
Okay.
And,
So you haven't told them. They think that you're going to meet them there and
you're
just
going to
go somewhere else.
Oh, my God.
Absolutely.
Professor Gregory, you're an asshole.
Thank you.
I think that we've kind of established that.
Yes.
Why are we friends with you?
Next thing you'll accuse me of is to going into your greenhouse.
What? Why are we friends with you?
So now let's go ahead and play the group going to Mr. Corbitt first.
Okay.
You arrive outside of his offices. There is a large dock. It's not a dock for a boat. It's a dock for a truck.
It's a freight
dock.
Okay. Yeah.
And there's a big metal door that's open. And we can say that maybe some of...
You muted there for a sec, Thom.
Oh, I'm sorry. We can say that you've Maybe some of you have actually been here before. You've walked by and dropped in. So you know that his desk is like over to the side inside the warehouse. Right. And
how many people?
It's very neat and clean. Maybe, you know, half a dozen people.
Okay.
And there's crates and stuff in his warehouse. And nothing really, really big. Though he could probably get you something really big if you wanted it.
Yes. I want a giant dragon-sized statue.
He could get that for you. It would cost you, but yeah, he could get it for you.
Yes, in my backyard.
A big old pagoda.
Yes. No, not really, though.
So you see him sitting there, and he's writing away at something, and he's sort of talking to one of his workers who's standing at the desk without actually looking at him. He's, you know, Benny, I need you to take the shipment to here and there and like that. And he's writing. So he doesn't see you guys coming in.
Okay. I just stand there until he notices us.
Yeah,
I don't want to.
I just kind of stand there dramatically. Yeah.
Well, the first thing that happens is one of the workers comes up and says, you know, can I help you?
Who is he talking to? Is he just talking to all of us? Does anyone want to answer?
Yeah, just sort of the group of you.
I got us here. Does anyone want to say anything?
Yeah. Oh yes. We were hoping to acquire about perhaps ordaining some furniture.
Okay. As soon as you start to talk, Mr. Corbitt looks up. Okay, and he's kind of surprised to see you all standing there. This whole group of his neighbors.
Minus and Gregory.
He goes like this. You know.
I kind of go over and say, hello, Bernard, or Miss Corbett, or Bernard.
Bernard.
Yeah, Bernard. How are you?
I'm fine. What are you all doing here?
Oh,
is there something wrong?
Oh, no, not at all. We actually were coming to ordain about some furniture.
Really?
Yeah.
For your house, or for...
Yes, for a house.
All of you?
Yes. See, that's the thing. Yes, that's correct, Bernard. See, we just realized that Robert's house needed. We were looking in the paper, and then we saw perhaps a woman mentioned something about a rug that you've got, and from your business, and instructed Robert that he needed a new rug. He wanted something that, you know, to help make our little gatherings a bit more pleasant. And I said I needed an armchair as well, so we all decided to come together.
Yeah, and I need new paintings, so that's... I just moved from my house, so I thought I'd pop by with them, because they're going to. So.
Why you need new paintings?
A new painting, like just a painting.
The idea, would I call him Bernard or Mr. Corbett?
Probably Bernard.
The idea, Bernard, is that we thought we'd come to you rather than go to a bunch of different shops, because, of course, you're our friend and neighbor.
Well, I'll tell you what, you know, if you look around at any of the shops in town and you see something that you like, just make a note of it and bring it to me, and I can probably get it from you for you wholesale. But I got a question for you.
Of course, what is it?
Where is Mr. Hall?
Wait,
why are you all here and he's not here? He isn't trying to break into my greenhouse.
Wait,
again.
No,
he?
Well,
no.
I don't
Me.
Think so. Weird. Well,
I bet he is.
Oh, Lord. Is he... did he break... Did he really break into your greenhouse?
He's trying to. I think so.
Oh, Lord. Jeez.
I don't know. Maybe if you guys... He seems to think I have some magical formula. It's just hard work and meticulous attention to detail is all...
I'm sorry, Mr. Corbett.
I'm gonna have to do something about that.
I don't know. Don't know, Mr. Bernard. I'm sorry.
Bernard, you know Gregory. He's just... He's a little all over the place.
In that house.
If I ever get that old and crusty, I want you guys to just have me committed and lock me up.
Don't worry, we'll be joining you together. regardless. Anyway,
yeah, if you see something you like, you're not going to see much in here. Everything is in crates.
Yeah, well, we figured, but still, we decided to go to you specifically, you know, since you're a friend.
Well, if you go to Brandon Green's in town, you can see a lot of his furniture there. He has oriental carpets and stuff. I'm sure that if you see something there, you know, you just tell him that, you know, you're my next-door neighbor, and he'll probably give you a discount. Well, he won't give you as good a discount as I will. I can get it for you. Also, if there's anything that you ever see in a catalog or some picture somewhere, I can probably get it for you. It'll take a couple of months to cross the ocean, but...
Yeah, naturally, of course. But thank you. You're a big help. We've been looking for a new carpet. This will make our gathering so much more pleasant.
By the way, speaking of our gatherings, mm-hmm. Robert and us, we got together on Sunday. We didn't see you there.
Well, you know, I'm just not a very social person. I like my privacy and I like my quiet.
Understandable.
I
read a lot
of books. I do paperwork and I do my little gardening experiments, and I'm trying to work on a super secret fertilizer formula. but I am trying to. I think I know what I'll do for Gregory. That's all. I'm just puttering around and doing my hobbies.
Of course. Of course. I understand. I try to keep, you know, let you keep to yourself, you know.
Keep going.
Oh, I was going to say, I'm sorry about Gregory. I know that it's not, you know, I hope he means well, but again, I'd rather him not bother you so much.
Hmm. Yeah.
Well, me too.
If you need us to speak with him, then let us know, but...
you know, I don't think that's necessary. I think I know exactly what I'm going to do.
Yeah, I think that you should just speak with him. He's a really a nice gentleman.
Yes. That's,
I know he doesn't mean any harm. He's obsessed. He's never been married, and he works a hard job. He's a surgeon, isn't he?
Yes.
Teaches surgery.
Yes.
Yeah,
I think so.
He's just a little obsessed.
Yes, of course. So
I'll try to satisfy his obsession.
Well, I don't think we'll bother you any further then.
Hey, you had a wife.
Tom, they're doing all this, Tom?
Oh, yeah.
I just wanted to casually look around and notice if there's any large coolers.
Yeah.
Coolers? Cooler. For putting meat in or something?
Yeah, no. Anything.
Funny you should say meat when you're talking about Gregory and throwing him underneath the bus when he mentions that everybody's there but him. Thank you, guys.
Hey, Gregory, you left us. You asshole. You left us.
They're pissed that you didn't show up.
I would like to look around, see if there's anything that's out of the... Like, just look around, see if I could see any, like, big, big crates.
No, there aren't any. I already said there weren't.
Yes.
You can do a spot hidden if you want.
Yeah, that's what I want to do. Just do a regular spot hidden, see what's up there. And I think I failed that. Yeah, I did.
Okay. Yes. So we're kind of closing in the you were going to say something, Will?
Yeah, I said you were married once, weren't you?
Yes.
Oh, so does he say it like really, very short, very like kind of like cold?
It's hard to... Well, you can do a psychology roll on it.
Let's do a psychology roll. My rolls have been so good, I know I'm going to fail this one. All right, let's find it. 1, 2. I was hoping I didn't have to. 75. What is my psychology? Ah, God damn it, 65. Okay.
The other, if any of you all were standing around, you can all do psychology rolls.
Sure, hooray, I have base, so maybe I'll get lucky. Who knows?
Yeah, maybe I'll get lucky too. You never know on that. It's
18.
Come on, let's get a 0-1. Oh, 28. No, I fail all on that.
So none of you?
No, I got close at 18 though, but.
Well, let's just say that it's the hesitancy in his voice is like, you know, I'm doing my job here and I need to concentrate, and you've just stuck your finger in an open wound.
Okay, so it was
that sort of look.
Okay, I put a hand on my chest and I say I meant no offense, of course, but I'm just. You know that having a wife can definitely help alleviate the obsession. Of course, Gregory wouldn't know that. He's not married. But you were, so.
Yes, I do agree. Gregory needs to get laid.
Whoa! Well put, Mr. Corbitt, and yes.
Well,
that would. Yeah, go find him a girlfriend.
Yes, that's what we should do, Mr. Corbett. You should come with us. We will go around the town, Mr. Gregory.
And he's kind of laughing, and he's like, "All right, gentlemen, I really have a lot of work to do."
Of course, of course.
If you don't mind.
Yes, yes. As we kind of go turn off, to go, I'm like, "Oh yeah, Mr. Benner, if it'd be all right, could I have a meeting with you later at my house or your house? I was hoping to get some more sponsors to help out my radio, my pulp radio broadcast."
And I'm sorry, who are you talking to?
Corbett or Mr. Bernard.
Bernard.
Like I said, one more thing. So I'm like, you know, I was hoping to arrange a meeting because I was thinking that maybe your company would like to sponsor my radio show, you know, as a way to get more business. And I'd like to talk to you more about it later. Is that all right? We can talk later. We can organize something. Does that sound good?
All right, we'll talk later.
All right, of course. Not now. You're busy. I understand. And I'll call you. You call me. We'll work it out.
And he looks at the same time like, yeah, he's not that interested in what you're talking about. He's got business connections and everything, but he's being polite.
Yeah.
You think that he's just being polite.
Yeah.
Oh, by the way, Robert.
Yes.
It looks like in a couple of weeks I'm going to have another business trip that I'm going to have to go on. I'll be going to New York for 2 days. Do you know if you'll be able to watch my place?
Sure, I think that'd be no problem. I'll check
all right.
with Margaret.
I'll bring the keys over when we get closer. If that brings up another thing, if any of you guys, I'm going to be going to New York. If any of you people need anything from New York, I can bring it back for you.
When do you go to New York, there, Miss Bernard?
It's in about 2 weeks. I don't have my schedule here.
Okay.
I think it's on a Wednesday.
Ouch. Yes.
Okay, I might have something for you, but I will see.
Yes, if you have any of the latest pulps from the magazine company over there, let me know.
All right, I'll take a look. Anyways,
thank you.
Good day, gentlemen.
Of course.
Okay.
All right, so you leave, and you're going to go hunt down Gregory and beat the crap out of him.
Yeah. Yeah. We're going to go bang on his house.
Yes. You're supposed to get me laid, damn it.
All right.
That was a lie.
Gregory, you are heading towards the hospital or the sanitarium?
The sanitarium. I'm going to follow up with what they say because I'm going to prove to these people that they are just cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs.
Okay. Well, the sanitarium is it's not like run like a hospital. You go into the front reception, I guess you'd call it a reception area, and there's a couple of nurses behind a desk, but the room is walled off. It's locked doors to get inside. And one of them says, "Yes, sir, may I help you?"
Can I speak to one of the attending physicians, please?
The attending physicians are all busy. What's the business? Do you have an appointment?
No, I don't. My name is Mr. Hall.
Mr. Hall. Oh, the other nurse suddenly recognizes you, and she says, "Aren't you a surgeon? Don't you teach surgery at Miskatonic?"
Yes, I do. I'd like to see any attending physicians for this delicate matter.
Well, let me see what I can do for you.
I smile politely and say thank you.
All right.
And I cast my nose down upon the nurse, as usual.
Just give me one second.
No, take your time.
All right, an older gentleman, older than you, ends up coming...
I was with Christ when he was a corporal. How could that be?
he comes out of the door, and he walks over to you. You think you've seen him before.
May I? Professionally.
No,
I've never been in a sanitarium.
No. I mean, as a doctor, you've maybe seen him at functions, or something like that. And he comes forward to you, and he reaches out to shake your hand, and he says, "Dr. Ken Russell, what can I do for you?"
Great. I would like to take some of your time when you get a chance so I can discuss something in private, if possible.
Well, I have 20 minutes right now. If you come with me to my office.
Oh, thank you.
And he takes you into his office, which is down the hall.
Okay.
And you got to go through security to get there.
Okay. I'm going to make a little
down behind his, he sits down behind his desk and has you sit down. What can I do for you?
I'm inquiring about a former patient, and I'll mention, I didn't get a chance to write the woman's names down. Was it Carol?
Mona
Dunlap.
What sort of patient? She's here?
I don't know if she's been here or she has been through here.
Well, let me check my records. Hold on just a second. And he gets out his computer and... back then they had typewriters.
I know,
he
gets out
his magical typewriter that the information just appears on.
Oh!
No, he goes over to a filing cabinet. Yeah, and he's going through the files. Dunlap. Here we are. Mrs. Mona Dunlap. And he pulls out the file and comes back to his desk. And he opens it up on his desk. And he's like, looks like that she was admitted here in 1911. She had almost catatonia. She had a stroke. And she... passed away about 6 years ago.
Oh, dear Jimmy. Died 6 years
attending, ago. Attending physician was Dr. Daryl Robertson. He's still here.
If I could speak with him just briefly about this former nurse of mine.
All right. Let me find out where he is, and I'll get back to you in just a moment. And he gets up and walks out the door. Leaves you there for.
I'll be a good neighbor.
Probably 10 minutes.
You know, I am so tempted to go and look at that file cabinet.
Well, it's on the desk right in front of you.
And you know, because I'm a real honest American, and I don't do things like that. So what's in a file?
Much more than what he said. It doesn't say anything. It's just the basic details that she was admitted.
I want next of kin because was she a miss or a missus? Because you said she was a missus.
She was a missus, but she was a widower.
Ah, okay.
She had been functioning as she had been a nurse, and she was functioning as midwife, kind of on the side. Not really on the side. She was a professional, but.
So maybe Bernard went to her directly, or was she working? Did it say that she was working someplace, or was it tied?
She was tied into Central Hospital.
Okay, so I'll have to check with Central Hospital and see who assigned her and what happened. Okay.
So after about 10 minutes, mm-hmm. He comes back and he's got this other doctor in tow. Oh crap! What name did I give him just now?
Robertson.
Yeah, Daryl Robertson, Dr. Daryl Robertson. And he says, this is Dr. Robertson. And he's like, what can I do for you? And he shakes your hand.
Doctor, give the doctor, common promises. Hey, doctor, doctor, doctor! Doctor. Yeah, yeah. Spies like us. I love that movie. It just reminds me of it. Anyhow, I ask about her condition when she was still alive.
And he sort of he looks a little concerned for a moment, but then he refreshes his memory from the family. He says, "Oh yes, that was really a very sad tragedy that was attached to that. She had been hired to assist the Corbitts in their having a child. She was an elderly woman. You should understand that."
Yeah.
And apparently she had a stroke while she was delivering the child. Apparently there were complications with the child. I mean, all of this is in the newspaper from the time. And apparently she keeled over, and Mr. Corbitt got home, he found his wife dead, his child dead, and the nurse catatonic on the floor. She was brought into the hospital, and she did not regain consciousness until maybe the last day that she was alive. She regained a little bit of consciousness, but all she said was gibberish, and she died shortly after that.
Well, that doesn't seem so... I mean, gibberish, you know, doctor, would seem kind of strange. I mean, you still would have the power of speech to speak English, but I'm wondering why she would be speaking...
Well, it wasn't really gibberish. She said something about no face, or... I don't exactly remember. It's been a long time.
Was she talking about the child?
I don't know what she was talking about. Like I said, it was just nonsense.
Was anybody that perhaps works here recalls the patient by any chance, if possible? Maybe one of the attendants?
I have no idea. Nurses come and go. Orderlies come and go.
Yes. Yes. But, would that report have a signature of somebody that might be here? Or even a name that I can track down?
I'm the attending physician, so my signature's there. That's it.
That's it? Okay. Fine. And I'm sorry to bother you, gentlemen, and everything. It's just so many things, and I drop...
Well, can we ask what this is about? Why are you interested in Mrs. Dunlap?
The reason is... She used to work with me, and I just want to put some rumors to rest, just like this strange rumors dealing with Robertson's that was working here as a janitor that the police talked to.
I don't know what you're talking about. I don't know any Robertson.
Well, there was just a rumor going around, and I was just putting it to rest. With my constituents, and I just appreciate your time and thank you so much.
Certainly. Let me show you out.
Absolutely. And, thank you so much.
The
I'd like to try to recall the gentleman that was in the paper that they were questioning, that was the janitor that's supposed to be working here at Central.
Do we have a memory? I guess you can do like an idea roll.
If possible. Okay, let me drop my screen for a second here for dice roll. Percentage die? Is that what I need?
Yeah.
Okay. I just drop it down. I just have to drop down my thing. Let's see, how do I want to drop this off? How do you drop this stupid thing off?
Oh,
oh, here we go. Zero one.
What?
All right. That's a good roll. Randolph Tomaszewski.
I'm going to mention...
Polish name.
Yes. Yeah.
Was there any connection between these two, by any chance?
Who are you talking about?
I'm going to slaughter his Polish name if you don't know.
No, I will do that.
Let's say Randolph Tomaszewski. Who is that?
I believe he was a janitor here.
No, he was admitted.
I don't even know if we who to ask.
No. He was orderly at the
Central. If he says,
let me check the records.
Yeah, and I'm sorry to bother you before I left.
He checks. It takes him a few minutes, and he says, "No, there's no Randolph Tomaszewski working working here."
Was he ever admitted? Perhaps.
Admitted? No, yes. We don't show any record for that.
Okay.
I don't show that we've ever had a Tomaszewski here.
This is not a very common name. Well, thank you for your time.
No, it's Polish, I believe.
Yes. I hope that the mess gets all cleaned up. I know that you guys had some serious problems down here.
Oh, yeah. We sent a portion of the patients that we felt were less...
Stable?
More stable over to the Central Hospital. But we had to keep a lot of the more dangerous patients.
I would like to drop off my resume here sometime. I am interested still in working.
Are you a psychologist?
Yes.
Okay. Sure, anytime.
And I'll take my leave. I don't know if that counts because my psychology is at 45%, I think. So I don't know if that counts. I think I got to...
You said what you said.
Yeah.
I'm not going to check you out right now.
Well, right, yeah.
All right, so they take you back, or they take you to the front door and let you go.
Yeah. Thank you. And that's it.
Mm-hmm. All right.
And... I'll see if they throw me underneath the bus in front of me, and I just will go on.
Well, before you go home, do another idea roll.
An idea roll?
Yeah.
Is it showing up now?
Yeah, it shows up.
Okay, cool. All right, let me go back to dice screen.
We saw about 7 rolls. Okay. It shows up a couple seconds after.
Just
progress first, and then...
Yeah.
All right, well, let me know if this is right. I'm going to erase. All right, and percentage rolls, survey says?
32.
What do we have? 32. And what am I looking for?
Idea roll.
Idea roll.
It's up at the top.
I switched names. My idea is at 80, so yes.
It suddenly occurs to you that Tom Ozowski is an orderly at the hospital, not at the sanitarium.
Thank you. Hospital, not the sanitarium. I will go there next.
All right. Let's jump back to the other people for a second. Mm-hmm. What do you guys want to do? You've left. You've left
that
the
asshole.
Yeah. Where is Gregory?
I'm just going straight to Gregory's house, and I'm gonna just wait for him because I'm mad.
Yes.
And I don't usually get mad, so I'm just gonna and mad for my character is I'm gonna have a stern talking to you.
Absolutely, damn it.
We're gonna have a stern talking.
I'm gonna be I'm gonna be waiting out, outside of his. And then I'm waiting, and I'll be with bolt cutters and going
I was actually hoping to go to the hospital without them knowing, because that was actually what I wanted.
Asshole!
Yes. I'm
asshole.
You know what?
So
I'll. Yes, you don't know. I guess you're not telling us that you're gonna go there.
No, I'm just saying.
Oh, follow Gregory. Follow Gregory, damn it.
Yes.
All right. So, Robert, what are you doing? Did you just go home or?
I'm confused. I don't know what's going on. I'm gonna hide in the bushes and wait for Gregory too.
Damn! I'm getting ambushed. Damn.
I'm just gonna follow along behind William and watch the fireworks.
All right.
Nice stern talking to.
Well, let's do this. We got Gregory and we've got Patrick's character, Sebastian. Both heading to the hospital without knowing that each other is heading to the hospital. And the rest of you seem to be waiting for Gregory to pop,
show up. With a big old, what do you call it, monkey wrench.
Now, where does Gregory live?
I'm on the corner, left side corner.
You're down there.
I am the last house on the left.
And, all right, so are you guys going to wait at Gregory's house, or are you just going to car?
Yeah, I was going to wait until we saw his car. I was going to wait until I saw his car.
Yeah, I'm going to wait, too, just because I'm like, you mother.
Mother Hubbard.
All right. Well, rather than go into the next part, since we're pretty close to 11 o'clock, I guess we can call it there, and then next week what we'll do is we'll pick up with it's going to have to be the people at the hospital, because obviously Gregory's not going to come home.
Yeah. No, because they throw me underneath the bus too many damn times. Maybe I do need to get laid.
Yeah, maybe that's why we're here, is to just help you. We're just here to help.
No.
So, cool. Now, next week we are not going to play, because I'm going to be flying.
Can't you just run the game while, you're flying?
The airplane?
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't have one of those sweet little laptops to do that sort of thing.
Yes. I mean, where's your dedication? I mean, you should annoy everyone around you just so we can play.
Well, I did play with you guys when I went to... that frickin' island that I stayed on for a week. What the hell was that? The Dominican Republic.
Yes.
All right, guys. Thanks for your participation, and thanks to all our viewers for watching. We hope you enjoyed our game session. Remember to subscribe to our YouTube channel, and if you'd like to join us as either a player or a GM in an upcoming game, feel free to contact me via email. Please tune in 2 weeks on Wednesday at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for the next episode of Mr. Corbitt. Until next time, always remember, if there's no light left to guide your path, Your only choice left is to venture into the darkness. Good night.